There are a few magical places on Earth. These mountains and forests are one of them. A place of incredible myths and enchanted legends, where man and wildlife have been living for ages. It has been transformed by kings and sung by poets. But at its heart, it remains wild. Where an old forest survives and secretive creatures still live. Immersed in a timeless realm of light, color, and motion. Mankind has found harmony and beauty achieved over the centuries. Its secrets are carefully kept, and its wonder and enchantments too great to ignore. Time guides the days and nights through the rhythm of the seasons, and each has its character. Peaks to the rough, arid landscapes, and from the coast to the hills, there are countless stories to be told. Sintra, the mountain of the moon. The Earth can get tired. For over 8,000 years, man has occupied this land, and for 8,000 years, it has exhausted it. For those who know Sintra, it is hard to believe that the whole of this area was once like this. Barren, depleted of trees and of life. But the same man who used up the mountain has since renewed it. She was reborn like a phoenix through the genius and the determination of those who envisioned a magical and sublime scenery where nature and mankind would coexist. The legacy of an enlightened few has endured to this day, presenting us with a truly unique wonder of our world. We are at the very end of a mountain range that crosses the whole of the Iberian Peninsula at its westernmost point. This is the same mountain range that includes the Serra da Estrela, the country's highest mountain at nearly 2,000 meters. Sintra rises up to 529 meters, which, due to its proximity to the sea, are enough to create a unique and very peculiar ecosystem. At the top of the mountain, there is a remarkable bird, one that is as beautiful as it is elusive. The blue rock thrush has a distinctive song, one more commonly heard at the very top of much higher mountains. But as we will see, most rules do not apply here. This is a place of too many exceptions, and that is mostly due to the weather. If there is one thing that characterizes Sintra, it is the fog. For centuries, she has been known for it, and it plays a part in the fantastic and mysterious aura it carries. When the cold Atlantic air is forced to rise over the forest, dense clouds are instantly formed and immediately venture inside the hills, as if they too were curious to discover the secrets underneath the canopy. Of course, the animals that inhabit the forest welcome the water that arrives from the sea. After all, water is life. The history of these hills is tightly linked to man's occupation of the country, and the two walk hand in hand. The Moors have built their castle on one of the hilltops to defend it from their Christian enemies. And around man's edifice, the forest has readily grown. The two have grown together, actually, each inspired by the other, on an evolution that has bettered both in ways that have yet to be achieved anywhere else on the modern world. This is the real legacy of Sintra. Eventually, the fog condenses, and the water flows gently into one of the thousands of streams that descend through the mountain. Like any luscious garden, this one is so rigorously watered. As we will see, the whole ecosystem and its many life forms are completely dependent on the abundance of water and humidity. These hills effectively form a network of freshwater creeks that keep it constantly wet enough for life to thrive, in many ways resembling a rainforest. And presented with such a habitat, many animals have seized their spot. All kinds of different species have long ago made Sintra their home. Among the most specialized of them, of course, are the amphibians. This is the fire salamander, and it is the most terrestrial of the salamanders of Sintra. These fantastic creatures can live to be over 50 years old, dwelling in the wet soils and puddles of habitats such as this. Mostly nocturnal, this species can sometimes be found wandering on the wet grounds of the forest during the darker and rainier days. Although they can spend long periods of time outside the water, they must return to it to breed every single generation they conceive. In these ponds there is a whole new world, unknown for most of the humans that visit this place. Among the seven species of amphibians that exist in Sintra, there is the Iberian newt. It's endemic to the western region of the Iberian Peninsula, and it inhabits freshwater ponds in cool areas around the country, spending most of his life inside the water, where it lives, breeds, and feeds. It requires pristine water conditions as it forages through the grasses, searching for small invertebrates and insect larvae. Amphibians have different developmental stages in their metamorphosis, and when they are tadpoles, they suffer incredible transformations. This is a tadpole of an Iberian ribbed newt. One day, it will become the largest of the salamanders of these hills, reaching the impressive size of 30 centimeters. To support all this variety of amphibians, it is necessary that the base of the food chain is healthy. And in Sintra, this is the case. All kinds of insects live here. It is they who will pollinate the plants, regenerate the decomposing matter, and guarantee that the intricate web of life doesn't fall apart in any given habitat. Flying insects have access to flowers and plants that heavier ones can't reach. Beetles, for instance, don't fly very often and prefer to walk to perform their many duties on firm ground. This is a wise choice, especially when there are skilled hunters around. How long must it have taken for the spider to evolve a substance, a design, and a net as perfect as this one for the purpose of capturing its prey? Life is certainly not without danger for flies and mosquitoes. Perils come from where they are least expected. This rocky wall displays a very beautiful and gentle flower. One that belongs to a plant that defies its very classification. The reason why this plant can settle on such barren rock is that it does not extract all of its nutrients from the soil. It is a carnivore, and it feeds on small flies. It attracts them with sweet promises of sugar, and it traps them in fatal embrace. In the small world of Sintra's insects, there is one who stands above it all, quite literally above. This is a stag beetle, and he is in a race against time. This is a male, and it must find a female quickly. It only has about 2 weeks left to live. This male is in trouble. It wasn't quite quick enough, and the female has already been charmed. And not only that, but the stag she is with is considerably larger than him. His approaches are not very convincing. It looks quite afraid of its larger rival, and justifiably so. Even so, he has to try. He won't get another chance. As expected, things don't go his way. The stag beetle is a very interesting being. It spends up to 7 years as a larvae, feeding on rotting wood. Even though in its adult form, when it must find a mate, he only lasts around 20 days. The male that does succeed has to ensure that the female lays their eggs on a prime piece of rotting wood, usually on old oak trees, a preference which links the species to the existence of a well-preserved habitat. Now, while the male protects the female, she digs inside the rotting wood where she will lay her eggs when they are fertilized. The stag beetle has its southernmost address in Sintra, and this is possible due to the mild temperatures that are felt all year round. Portugal's native forest can be found in some scattered patches of the mountain. In some of its inaccessible places, where cattle couldn't graze and where fire couldn't reach, the native species endured through the millennia, bringing the wild forests to the present times. Cork oaks, oaks, holly, chestnut trees, and hundreds of other Mediterranean species form the unique relic forest that once occupied the entire length of the mountain. And this biotope is of extreme importance for these native and sensitive species of animals. At dawn and dusk, the robin's song echoes through the woods, indicating a healthy population of males claiming their own territories. One wonders how many kings, poets, and travelers were inspired by this song in this celebrated location among Europe's exquisite holiday settings. Life here isn't concerned with who might have come here. It has more practical issues at hand. In the robin's case, it must secure a hunting territory to impress a female, and that is all. But this forest has enough niches to accommodate a wide range of different and wonderful species. An infallible character of European stories and tales of old is the fox. It couldn't be absent in Sintra. There was a time when deer, wolves, lynx, and even bears walked through the mountain, but today they are all extinct from here. Of all these, only the fox, with its incredible adaptiveness, was able to stay and strive. However, foxes have a modest population in these hills, but a stable one. And for now, we needn't be concerned with its survival. The native patches of forest that survived the harsh centuries of pasture and desertification are a relic of a time when they covered the entire land. The relic forest of this region of the world is getting rarer every day, and it contains species that hold the key to the adaptiveness to the Mediterranean climate. And there is a species that only exists here in the whole of continental Portugal. It hasn't been common for at least 10,000 years in Europe. Today, it is restricted to some of the Atlantic islands and to Sintra, which makes it a very valuable species of this site. It is a fern with a leaf shaped like a common ivy. A truly prehistoric form that thrills the enthusiasts that come across it. Today, the best preserved patch of relic forest in Sintra is located around an old Franciscan convent. The convent was built on one of its hilltops. The foundations of the convent are encrusted on the rocks of the hill, and its architecture camouflages it in its surroundings. The perfect example of sustainable construction. It is of humble stature, and the friars that lived here for almost 300 years proved to be tireless in their efforts to preserve the good conditions of the native forests around the convent that is today known as the Convento of the Capuchos. Only 4 years after the friars left the convent, the King of Portugal was to buy the Pena estate on one of the hilltops of Sintra. Soon after, he created one of the most iconic monuments to the Romantic period, which was in vogue at the time, by building and creating the Palace and Park of Pena. Soon after King Ferdinand II's endeavor, Francis Cook, the rich English industrial, was to create his own vision on the Montserrat estate, building a palace and its surrounding gardens in spectacular fashion. These two men are responsible for having imported more than 100 exotic species of plants to Sintra, carefully displaying them to look spontaneous, mixing species originally from the four corners of the world brought by the Portuguese ships that were arriving from the newly discovered worlds. More than 150 varieties of plants from distant locations such as Mexico, Brazil, New Zealand, Japan, and Australia, among many others, were planted and kept for Europe's high society to enjoy on the many parties and occasions that were hosted in these estates. At this time, Sintra had its most glorious period, as it was sung by poets and painted by artists from all over Europe, visited by kings and the prettiest dames of the continent. The brilliant result of the unique vision and endeavor of its creators was in 1995 declared a World Heritage Site by UNESCO. The cultural landscape of Sintra was to be engraved alongside mankind's greatest achievements forever. In some parts of the mountain, the native and the exotic can easily get confused. In order to replant these hills, to prevent desertification, one of the most planted species was the white cedar. In the area of the Peninha, many were planted to repopulate the forest. These white cedars adapted so well to the climate of the country that an English naturalist called them Cupressum lusitanica, thinking it was an endemic form of Portugal. The species is actually native from Central America, but the name has remained the same, a reminder of the species' ability to adapt. Today, the exotic species are kept for different purposes, mostly economic ones. Specific areas are separated for planting eucalyptus trees for wood production, which consist of a source of income for the authorities managing the area. These are the poorest areas for wildlife in the entire mountain, as is the case with most monocultures. This is a reminder that we need to find alternative methods for wood production, as is currently being done in Sintra. Pines are kept for the same purpose, although they are native from Portugal, so they are no strangers to this place. Native or not, all these trees produce tons of decaying matter each year, and the ecosystem needs to be regenerated and recycled constantly. There is a whole kingdom of life dedicated to decaying and rotting matter, one that is essential to life as we know it, and that is exquisitely represented in Sintra. On the lower layers of the forest, hidden under the vegetation, are the fungi. The mushrooms are the visible part of the life forms that feed on the remains of the forest, the saprophytes, as they are called. There are at least 156 species described in Sintra so far, an outstanding number for any location of the planet. They come in all forms and shapes. Each design was carefully generated through millions of years with just one criteria: reproduction. Their colors are meant to attract a specific disperser, like a particular insect would prefer yellow and another one would prefer red. Some are poisonous and wear vivid colors to deter those who would want to eat it. And some look as though they were designed by man himself. One thing is certain, without them, the cycle wouldn't be complete, and the forest would never have achieved the greatness of its present state. When spring arrives, the entire mountain begins a new cycle. Mating time is here, and the attention is all focused on finding food for the next generation. This blue tit has built a nest in an old stone wall, and she has three little chicks to feed, what should keep her busy over the next few weeks. The forest has plenty to offer for those who choose to reproduce here. Some are satisfied with little holes on a wall. Others, not so much. Larger predators need a viewpoint to manage their territories. On a quiet hill, populated by cedars and oaks, there is a small family of tawny owls. This amazing little chick is still far too young to understand what is going on around her. It has barely stepped off the nest and is at its most fragile state. Its mother is well aware of this, and she remains very close by. This one is restless. It must be worried about the other chicks. Usually 3 hatch per clutch, so there should be others nearby. Their impressive mimetism makes them a difficult animal to observe, as is the case with most of the animals that inhabit the hills, especially because most of them are nocturnal. As the hour advances, another face of the mountain is slowly revealed. Strange creatures will rise from the ground to take their place in the amazing stage that is the night. The common toad is the largest frog in Portugal, and its monstrous appearance is imposing. It has spent the day buried under the dirt, keeping its skin wet, waiting for its turn to come out to life again. It is a peculiar creature indeed, and one of the first night crawlers to get busy. When the sun starts to set, the mountain is transformed. Warm colors fill the air, and these mystic hills start to show another face. The daytime agitation and commotion is washed away and forgotten, and a different mood sets in for a while. Soon, the night will arrive to the Mountain of the Moon. As the night advances, the city sleeps, and the moon keeps enchanting its mountain far below. There is still one presence felt in the darker hours in the forest. An elusive creature has left its den, and it is wandering through the branches and trails of the hills. A genet. The graceful and quiet genet is a magnificent hunter. She was brought by the Moors to the Iberian Peninsula and quickly found her way to the wilderness. Before the first rays of sun appear, she will be long gone, hidden in her den for the hours of the day. The sun comes back to to impose its overwhelming presence over Sintra yet again. The temperatures will slowly rise, and the creatures of the night will by now have settled in again. The sun needs to be high for its light to penetrate the dense foliage, and in a few hours it will have done just that. The rays of sun swirl to find their way around the trees, and the light hides more than it reveals. This eagle owl has stayed behind. It is extremely hard to spot one, but indeed the dawn is the best time to catch them off guard. It too is a night predator, the most impressive of the Iberian fauna. The eagle owl nests on cliffs, but it preys in the forest. It scans the forest one last time, just before lifting off to return to its hide among the cliffs of the mountain. As we go to lower altitudes, the terrain settles on the northern side of the mountain. Here, the great amounts of water soaked in by the forest are joined together in the small rivers of Sintra. Countless courses of water lead it away from the top towards the sea, where they will end their journey in the ocean. There are two very important streams in the vicinity. Their waters are in good condition, and to prove it are the communities of frogs and toads that inhabit them. Amphibians are always a good indicator of the quality of the waters, and here that is no exception. This is the Samara stream, a small habitat, but its good conditions make it a home for a number of important species. This river has been around long enough for the Romans to have crossed it, but today it is of greater importance than it ever was. The Samara is one of the few places where a critically endangered species of our world can be found. This freshwater fish is endemic of this region of the planet. It can't be found anywhere else in the world. It is amazing that we can find it here in the municipality of Sintra. This is a very populated area, but the streams and rivers seem to be clean enough for the many species that thrive on them. It can live to be 10 years old, and a female can lay up to 7,000 eggs in a single mating season. Even so, it is critically endangered. Local authorities are seriously engaged in its preservation, and to manage for its survival would be a great achievement for all of us. The river goes on to meet the sea through the length of its rocky bed towards the west. It reaches at the end of its journey from the hilltops to the Atlantic. Sintra is inside a protected area. The Sintra-Qashqaish Natural Park goes from the town of Qashqaish in its southern limit to the mouth of the São Julio River in its northern end. It was declared a natural park in 1994, and it has an area of nearly 15,000 hectares. Within the park, besides the mountain, there are other types of habitats. And although the protected area is inserted within a very populated area of Portugal, it still manages to keep safe some of its wildlife. These small patches of farmed land still give plenty of room for wild varieties of shrubs, and small lizards and rodents actually find these environments very accommodating. And so do their predators, which have also established themselves here. The area of the park is a large one, and the need was felt to protect it from human over-exploitation. It was an important measure for the country as a whole, and the results are here for everyone to see. The coast is a very good habitat for many species, some of them very well known to us. Rock pigeons have occupied the cliffs that rise right by the sea on the edges of the mountain. These are the wild cousins of the city pigeons. Away from its urban relatives, this one lives in the wild. And living in the wild has its dangers. Flying high in the sky, there is a feared predator that often spreads terror amongst the flocks of rock pigeons. A kill was made. The Bonelli eagle, it is a formidable predator, and it claims the lives of its victims relentlessly. She has caught a pigeon, and she is having a feast. Bonelli eagles feed on a wide range of prey, but preferably pigeons and grouse. These eagles once lived numerously in the whole of Portugal, but currently the population on the northern half of the country has been decreasing, and this is a tendency that is currently affecting several other countries in Europe. In the Sintra mountain, there is only one couple, which has been nesting here for a few years. This couple has thus an important part to play in the recovery of the population, and here, with a rich territory, they might have the conditions to do so. We can only hope they choose to stay here for the remaining duration of their lives. The mountain goes all the way right to the edge of the sea. This dynamic setting is the home of many. Several species have specialized in living on the coast, which, though dangerous, offers plenty of opportunities. This coast is a habitat which is home for several species of maritime birds who use the rocks to nest and for shelter. And also for the wading birds who patrol the beaches. This is a stopping point for thousands of visitors year-round, among them some of the greatest travelers of all. This is an alpine accentor, a rare bird in Portugal. It comes here for the winter, staying until late March before leaving towards the northern regions of the globe once again. Maybe it enjoys coming to Sintra to stay close to the sea, or maybe it is because of the forest. Here, we never know. A lot remains to be said about Sintra. Its beauty will continue to charm whoever visits it.